We just want to stop and worship you for a few minutes. Can we do that? Amen. We want to welcome tonight our visitors from Lifeline, all these guys here. Thank God for you. We'll be doing some baptisms after a while. Someone told me a while ago about you guys being baptized, some of y'all's friends. Said, can you hold them under just a little bit longer? We have a lot of fun. We do. Don't forget all the prayer requests. We've got so many on our list that need a touch from God. Let's continue to pray for them. Don't forget, October 7th is coming up real quick. The hayride with hot dogs. We'll be leaving here. We'll be eating over here, probably in the pavilion or fellowship hall. I don't know which. But we'll do that over there. And then we're going to do the hayride from here. We'll go out to, Alexander Loop? And go around and come back that way. We'll have two wagons. Each wagon probably hold, 15 or 20. Y'all be aware of that. Here comes my R6 guys coming in. Y'all give them a hand. All right. Don't forget this. Also, October the 16th, the whole church will be going to Columbus Park for a service down on in the park. We'll be on the, not on the bluff, but down. Robert, are we down near the parking lot?
Yep.
Okay, we're down low. So. All right, let's remember this, October the 16th. All right. All right, we're gonna get this thing started. We're gonna sing some hymns. I don't know what all Greg's got lined out over there, but we just want to worship the Lord tonight and thank God for life itself. Thank you for salvation tonight. As we come, and we've got three guys here tonight. They're gonna be baptized from Lifeline, and I'm looking forward to that. So God is still on the throne, folks.
Amen.
All right. Is there anything I've missed, any kind of sickness or somebody in the hospital that I don't know about? I've got three over here that snuck off the Lamberts without us today. That's just wrong.
Real wrong.
Yeah.
Next time you'll call and invite us, and then when we go again, we'll call and invite you.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Yeah. All right. That's fair enough. All right. Anything else before we start? All right. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, we thank you, God, for tonight. Lord, we thank you for your people. God, as we see this group of people sitting here tonight, all these, our church and these visitors, God, I thank you for them. I thank you for the lives they represent, what you've done in their lives, the accomplishments and the goals in their life that you've allowed them to go for. Lord, tonight, as we baptize these three men, God, I thank you for that. I thank you for your precious word and how it changes people by your spirit. And, Lord, we look forward to that tonight. And, God, I just pray for our church and every church around us, Lord, that your truth be preached from the pulpits. God, every pastor around us, God, that you would anoint them. And God, just loose them and let them preach, Father, your word. God, that you might move on the hearts of your people, that they might come to know you and ask you for salvation. Thank you, Jesus, for these three men, God, that have been saved. And there's many more. Lord, I just pray for them, all these men, God. I just pray for them, their families, and all that they have. God, that you restore to them the joys that they had. And God, just move them up, God, in this world. Just bless them in every way they turn. Thank you, Jesus, for what you're going to do tonight. Fill this place with your spirit. God, we want to meet with you tonight. We don't want just a dull, mundane service tonight. Lord, we want to meet with you. We want the spirit to move in our hearts tonight. And God, I pray that as the spirit moves, that we may not be afraid to lift our hands and say, thank you, Jesus. And God, just praise you for who you are. Thank you, God, for tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Believe in church.
Amen.
Amen.
Good to see all of you this evening. Glad to have you guys with us, worship with us. Just lift up the name of Jesus. We're going to start out tonight, Lord's Day. Coming out of that grave tonight, as Brother Mickey preached this morning about Lazarus. Jesus bringing Lazarus out of the grave. And I pray that God has brought you out of the grave and unbound you from sin and the things that hold you down. And so we're just going to show them some love tonight. I hope y'all ready. Got your shouting shoes on and ready to get your praise on tonight. And so let's start out with Glorious Day.
Oh!
All right, let's fill a little bit of my Jesus. Did I go get that worked out or not?
Well, I think I'm gonna do it after meet your preacher.
Okay.
Is it hurting when you're heavy? Is it all too much to carry? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Do you feel any feeling? Shame's on all that's healing. And you're desperate for some healing. Let me tell you about my Jesus. He makes a way.
Jesus, His love.
Lord, I lift your name on high.
give Christian a hand. I asked him before service, I said, Christian, man, you got no drums, no piano. He said, what are you going to do? He said, man, I got this. I can play anything. Okay, go ahead. We fight many battles in this life, in this side of eternity. And we see victories from time to time. Ukraine is fighting Russia. The Middle East is fighting Israel. There's fighting everywhere you look. And there are many battles, no doubt, that are being won from place to place. But can I tell you tonight that the greatest victory you will ever find,
Yeah, come on.
It's not on the battlefield.
That's right.
It's at the cross of Calvary. It's where it's fought for your life. But we wonder sometimes in our life what God is trying to show us or what He's trying to do for us. And sometimes we get so far out there that we're not in touch with God, and we want to be in touch. It's not that we don't want to be. Sometimes it's just that we let the world creep into our lives and causes us to make decisions that we wouldn't normally make. And We turn a deaf ear to the gospel sometimes, and then we turn and we cry out to God. And I find the psalmist David, King David, did that quite often. He cried out in Psalms 51 where he said, God created me a right spirit and a clean heart. And he was overwhelmed with godly sorrow for what he had done. He had sinned against God. And I believe that you and I, when we commit a sin against heaven, against God, we should be like that. And maybe we should cry out like David here. Turn with me in your Bibles to Psalms 139. I'm going to start there. I'll end up back in the Old Testament part of it. But I just want to put a thought in your mind before we start. Go back there. Because I believe it would do us good to cry out to God. And maybe not use these exact words, but something like this. Because we all are a work in progress, if you will. We haven't attained anything. We haven't arrived yet. God is still working on us, and that's an everyday event. So the psalmist David in Psalms 139, he cried out to God, and listen to what he said. O Lord, Thou hast searched me and known me. Thou knowest my down sitting and my uprising. Thou understandest my thought afar off. Thou compassest my path and my lying down, and art acquainted with all my ways. For there's not a word in my tongue, O Lord, that Thou knowest it altogether. Thou hast beset me behind and before, and laid Thine hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high, I cannot attain it. Whither shall I go from Thy Spirit, or whither shall I flee from Thy presence? If I ascend up to heaven, Thou art there. If I make my bed in hell, behold, Thou art there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even Thy hand shall lead me, and Thy right hand shall hold me. If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me, even the night shall be light above me. Yea, the darkness hideth not from thee, but the night shineth as the day. The darkness and the light are both alike to thee. For thou hast possessed my reins, thou hast covered me in thy mother's womb. I will praise thee, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are thy works, and that my soul knoweth right well. O God, as we come into your presence tonight, Lord, I just want to stop for just a minute and thank you, God. God, for what you've done in my life. Oh God, your darkness went away. That darkness and sin that I was in was drifted away by your presence. The darkness couldn't attain the light. And when your light came into my life, oh, it was daylight and dark. God, I thank you for that. I thank you for every heart here tonight. Lord, there may be some here that don't know you tonight. God, I pray before this service is over, they will bow a knee and say, Lord, I need you. I need your salvation. I don't want to live like that anymore. I want you, God, to change my life. Lord, I know that you can do that because you did it for me. Lord, I pray that you bless this service. Send your spirit even right now. Let it move from pew to pew right now. Search out those hearts. Search them, God. You'll find a heart, Lord, I know, that's willing to receive you tonight. Thank you, Jesus, for who you're going to save tonight. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. Psalm 139 is, David is simply giving his thoughts to the world, to us today. And in the latter part, the last two verses of that, I like what he says. I didn't read it, but it's on verse 28 and 29. He says, know my thoughts. See if there is any wicked way in me. If there is, lead me in the way of everlasting. David is begging God to look at his life. And he's asking God, he said, God, if there's something in me that shouldn't be, if there's some feeling or some resentment or some hatred or some sin, God, would you look at me tonight and search my heart? And what when you find something in me, God, that's not supposed to be there, would you take that out of me? Would you remove that from my heart and my life so that it won't be a stumbling block to me, that I can move towards you, God, and I can serve you more than I ever have, God. I can live a life that's pleasing to you, God. Oh, God, I'm tired of living for the world. The world has had my life. It's chewed me up and spit me out. God, I need something from you tonight. I need a word from you tonight. I need somebody to come into my life, oh, God, and search me and tell me who I am, because I want to know who I am with you, God. I want to be in your presence tonight. I don't care what the world has to offer anymore. I don't have anything out there that I need. What I need tonight, Lord, oh God, search me. I need Jesus in my heart tonight. David knew all too well when he wrote this song what it meant for God to search a heart, because God had searched his heart. David, now I don't know if y'all know about this. Everybody puts King David. King David was a good man. King David sinned. King David committed adultery. He committed murder. He sinned greatly against God. And God took that child out of an adulterous affair. He did. But David rose up from the ashes and said, oh God, I know who I am now. I know that you still love me. I know that nothing could separate us from the love that you have for me and the love that I have for you. And God, would you restore what you had gave me in the beginning? Would you restore my salvation? Would you give me that right heart and that right spirit? God, I want to live the rest of my life for you. I don't want to make them. I've learned from those mistakes, and I don't want to do that anymore. I want to serve you, God, for the rest of my life.
Amen.
Is anybody in the building tonight at that place in your life? Or you're saying, God, I done been down that road.
Come on.
I don't need to go back down that road.
Yeah. Come on.
I've lost too much on that road.
That's right.
The enemy has moved into my life from time to time and stole everything I had. Am I talking to anybody tonight?
Amen.
In 1 Samuel chapter 30, you don't have to turn there, I'm going to tell you the story. You can turn there if you want to. In chapter 29, let me tell you where David's at right here. David has been living with the enemy. And the enemy got tired of David. They didn't trust David. Isn't it odd that a man of God would try to live with the enemy to start with? He knew who he was. He'd been anointed. But here he finds himself running from murderous people, and he's living with the enemy, living with the Philistines, and even the Philistines, the enemy, the devil, didn't even trust him. He said, "You ain't going to war with me, buddy." He said, "Because you're liable to turn Jesus on me right in the middle of the war." Yeah, that's what he told him. He said, "We can't trust you. You just go on home." So David went to his home. His home at that time was in a little city called Ziklag. When David and his 600 men rode over the hill, some of y'all know the story. He rode over the hill, and when they could see the little city that they lived in down at the bottom of the valley, it was on fire. The enemy had been to Ziklag and destroyed everything that those men had worked for all their life. How many of you here tonight had good things in this life? Had good jobs? Had good paying jobs? Had good things going on in your life, a wife and kids? And all of a sudden, the enemy moved in and you lost everything you had. Yeah. David was at that point. He looked down and saw Ziklag on fire, and they hurried down, and come to find out the enemy had not only destroyed their homes, but the enemy had taken their wives, their daughters, and their sons, and took them away captive. He had lost everything he loved. It said the men and David wept until they couldn't weep anymore. When you find yourself in a place like that, when you can do nothing but sit on your bed and cry, because the enemy has stolen everything that you love, and you have no power over the enemy, you feel like you have nothing, you can't fight the enemy, and you've been fighting all your life, and now he's stolen everything you've got, and you seem, if you think that you're helpless, sitting, all you can do is weep. Just happened. I've lost everything. But then the Bible says his men, the very ones that stuck closest to him, talked about stoning him. His own men. Because they were in such anguish and such a hurting place in their life that they were ready to turn on whoever they could. And David was a good target. Their leader. Isn't it funny how when the enemy attacks us, we want to attack somebody that we love? We want to hurt. See, when the enemy comes into our life and tries to destroy us, what do we do? Instead of running to God, we try destroying other people around us, and we take everybody with us in the mix.
That's right.
Yeah, we do. Ziklag is burned. The women and children are gone. And the men are talking about stoning David. But David knew what he had to do. You read the verse there, verse 30, or chapter 30. It said, but David got all by himself. Y'all listen to what I'm telling you?
Yeah, come on.
He got all by himself. Everybody was talking about killing him. They done lost everything. There was no hope in the camp. There was nothing but gloom and doom. And what did David do? David found
solitude, he got on his knees over there and encouraged himself in the Lord Jesus Christ. He began to call on the name of God and said, "Oh God, I have no strength. I have nothing. The enemy took everything I've got. I need you tonight, God. I need you to move in my life. I need a victory in my life tonight."
God heard David. He called Abathar. He called the priest. And he said, "Bring me the priestly vessel." He said, "I need to confer with God." And he put on the priestly garment. He was in the mood to talk to God. And so he put on that robe and he cried out to God. He said, "God, I need an answer tonight. The devil, the enemy has stolen everything I've got. Lord, I can't do this by myself." How many of you realize that you can't do, you can't get victory in your life by yourself? You can try, you can go to every rehab program in the world. You can go to every jail in the country. You can go to every self-help place, every place of comfort. You can find a bed here, there, and everywhere. But until you find a place like David did in solitude and call on the name of Jesus, he will change your life. You can't do it on your own. I see people trying. I see people trying to do that from time to time in the ministry. And I find them back in the same place they were 6 months down the road because they didn't include God in the equation.
Amen.
David encouraged himself and he called on God, said, "God, can I go get my stuff that the enemy stole? God, are you going to go with me? Are you going to fight with me, God? I need you, God. Lord, I need you to fight this battle for me. I don't have enough. I've got 600 men, God, but they're weary. Man, we've been riding for 3 nights and 3 days. We're dead tired. God, I need you tonight." God says, "Go ahead. I'll go with you." How many of you know that when you're really desperate for God, He loves to step into your life.
Yeah,
he loves to come alongside you and say, "Here I am." You go ahead and pursue that enemy. He's got no hold on you. He's got nothing for you in your life. Listen, the enemy has no hold on your life. He doesn't have permission. The only way he can touch your life is to get permission from God. And I don't know about you, but God ain't giving him permission lately to destroy my life. Why? Because God is still living in me. I've got the light of the world living in me. I've got a Savior that's overcome the world. He that is in me is greater than he that is in the world. I've got Jesus on my side tonight.
Amen.
He said, "Okay, God, let's go." So they leave the Ziklag on the trail of the enemy. They get to a little river. 200 of the men said, "David, we ain't got no strength. We can't go no further. We're just fed tired." And David, the Bible says they were faint. Anybody here ever just get faint in the Lord? You feel like just sitting down and saying, "God, I can't do this anymore. I'm so tired of fighting. I just can't move anymore. God, would you just let me sit here and just be still and know that you're my God for a while?" God loves you to do that sometimes. And so the 200 men, David said, "That's okay, boys." He said, "Me and this other 400 are going. Y'all just stay here by the river and we'll come back and get you." In the process, when they crossed the river, I'll try to hurry. When they crossed the river, it said they came upon a man, an Egyptian, in the middle of the wilderness, all by himself out there. And David came to the man, and he said, "Man, who do you belong to?" And he said, "I belong to the enemy that just destroyed your village."
He said, I got sick and I got down and I couldn't go on any further. And the enemy, the Philistines, turned me loose, left me here to die, and just took off with all of y'all's kids and wives and just left me here to die. The enemy didn't care about me. Oh, as long as I was strong and helping the enemy, he had something for me, and he was spoiled. But listen, when I got sick and I couldn't do anything, the enemy chewed me up and spit me out. I'm here to tell you tonight, that's what the enemy does in your life. If you follow the devil and somewhere down the line, he's going to get tired of you, and he's going to chew you up and spit you out in the wilderness and let you die.
That's right.
That's what he does. Now this man had just destroyed David's village, burned everything that he had, and had been running with the men that had his wives and children. Now, I know what me and you would have done. Yeah. Well, I'm glad you left, they left you here in the wilderness, because now I'm going to kill you. Now, you know what David did? This is how God moves a heart that loves him.
Yeah.
He said, bring me some bread and bring me some water and give this man to eat and to drink and let him live. That's God. You see, Jesus said, I'm the bread of life and the water is my Holy Spirit. When you live and you live for Jesus, you live by Him and Him alone. And so the Egyptian lived. He was nursed back to health. And they asked him, said, man, do you know where these people were going? He said, yeah, I know where they're going. And David said, can you go with us and show us where the enemy's camp is? He said, I sure can. I can take you right there. He took them to the enemy's camp. And David snuck up to the camp at night and looked down and saw his wives, his children, and all his men's wives and children were there in the camp. He said, God, here they are. Here's the enemy, God. This is the woman I've been waiting for, God. This is why I called on you back in Ziklag, God. What are we going to do now, God? God said, go in there and wipe them out. David and his men went in and wiped the enemy out. He recovered his wives and his children. He recovered what the enemy had stolen in his wife. Can I tell you tonight? Can I tell you tonight that you may be sitting here in this room tonight and you may have lost the same thing that David did. You may have lost your wife. You may have lost your children to the enemy because of some stupid mistake or some decision that you made, and you sided with the devil there for a while, and you've lost everything. But I got good news for you tonight. You don't have to stay that way. The enemy, listen, the enemy may have taken a lot of stuff from you, but I got good news. You've got a way to get it back if you'll hook up with Jesus. It said the enemy left everything they had in the camp when they took off running. And David killed them all. They picked up all the spoil, and it said it was a great amount of stuff. Food, clothing, jewels. They get back to the 200. Remember them? The ones that didn't go fight. They were too faint. They get back to those 200, and David said, divide the spoil among all of you. 400 of them, they was with David, but they didn't know the God David did. I said, whoa, David, wait a minute. You want us to give them part of our stuff that we went and fought for? and they sat over here on the riverbank and watched the sun, and didn't them, you want us to share with them when they ain't done nothing?
David said, my God supplied my needs.
That's right.
Yeah.
And what God gave me,
yeah,
he gave it to me, yeah, to share with everybody that he loves. And that means, yeah, them.
Yeah.
Can I tell you tonight that when God restores your stuff to you, when God restores the riches of this life, that the abundance of life, when he restores what you've lost, the enemy has stolen, can I tell you, you can't help but share it with somebody. You're going to tell somebody how good God is and what he's done in your life, how he's restored your life. He's going to run over and run out. You can't contain the goodness of God in your heart. He's so good to us. David recovered that he had. Let me ask you tonight. Do you need Jesus to go with you tonight? Do you need him to walk with you through this life so that you can recover what you've lost? Do you need to take a trip to the enemy's camp tonight and ask God, God, would you do that for me? Would you restore my children? Would you restore my life? Would you come and go with me and lead me by the hand and say, I don't know how to do this, God. I don't know how it's going to work. I don't know how it's going to turn out. But God, I need you to come and get what I've lost. I need you to make a way where I can't see a way. Lord, I can't see you moving. But God, I know that I can trust you with my life. There's many in this room, I know, be willing to stand and say that tonight. Because you've lost much.
Amen.
The enemy has destroyed your life. But all thanks to God.
Yeah.
That he makes a way where you've never seen a picture,
right,
in your life. You'll see the greatest victory in, yeah, your life that you never thought would happen. Oh, listen. I've seen grown men fall on their knees bawling, crying out to a holy God and saying, God, I need you tonight. I've got stuff in my life that I don't know how to deal with. I've got stuff going on. The enemy has been bombarding me with stuff for so long that I've become numb to the truth.
Yeah.
But the truth will set you free.
That's right. Yeah.
That's who Jesus is tonight. He is the truth. Have you been set free? Do you need God to restore your life what the enemy stole from you? Right now is your opportunity. Greg's going to come. We're going to sing a hymn of invitation right now. And if you've got something in your life, just like David, he encouraged himself. He got on his knees and said, God, I need you. I can't fight this battle by myself. If that's you, would you just make your way to this old-fashioned altar tonight and tell God, I need you tonight. I need you. I need a victory. I need my stuff, God, that the enemy has stole over the last few years. Oh, God, I need you in my life. If that's you, you come on right now. Would you stand with us tonight?
Say,
Lord, I need you tonight. Lord, I've been living like hell. I need you to come and forgive me of my sins. Wash me white as snow. Make me clean, God, and save my soul. Would you come? Oh, don't put him off. He's right here tonight. I can feel his presence all over this room. He's calling your name tonight.
Tested and tasted your grace.
Would you come?
I was so lost till I fell at the cross and God saved.
You come. Oh, let God have a prayer for
you. I'm under by the mercy of Jesus. I'm under by the goodness of the Lord.
Yeah. baptize thee, my brother David, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost.
Okay. I just came from the open room probably about in God's way that I separated from him. Since I've been in jail, since I've been in rehab, you got to put the work in. Where you're going to continue to go back out and do whatever you want to do. Look at y'all, y'all still got a chance. Some people don't come back.
That's right.
I didn't really have a speech. I didn't even know I was going to do this, but God led me here to tell y'all I'm no better than y'all. That I'm fighting a good fight each day. That's all we can do. And just give it to God.
That's right.
Amen. God first, and everything will follow behind.
That's right. That's God. That's right.
Just fresh out myself, about 7 to 10 days. Do what you gotta do. I mean, I'm gonna say for myself, I gotta go to counseling, I gotta celebrate recovery. Yeah. Being something that's as bad as you wanted with your addiction, you know what I'm saying?
But
we did what we could to, you know, get out and get what we needed, or we gotta get out and give it to God. And being something like other people, I thought it was weird. I've done this before, I've been in several, but this time in life I changed my heart. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
If you don't change your heart,
that's right.
You're going to continue to be hitting walls, jails,
yes.
Rehabs. That's, I'm just saying what I know from experience, and you know, I'm fighting for my family back, you know what I'm saying? But it's on God's time right now.
That's right.
That's right.
God's going to take care of it, but I got to follow God.
That's right. Now, many of you don't know who Sean is. Sean, how old are you now, Sean?
41.
34 years ago. I picked Sean up on the west side of Chicago. Remember that?
Yeah.
Brought him home. He was just a little kid. And I'm so proud of what Sean has done in his life. He's made a mess. That ain't nothing God can fix. Thank you, Sean, for being here. Yes, ma'am.
You know, I've just got to say something about you. Listen, you guys, I had a son, and I won't say he's a world alcoholic, but he was bad, let me tell you, bad, bad, bad. For years, we battled with him, trying, begging, pleading, praying, and nothing we said or done helped him. And I kept telling him, I said, Roy, you've got to let go and let God. You just got to. That's the only thing that will help you. And finally, he did. He came over here to Brother Mickey's church. Brother Mickey, I thank God every day for his heart for men with problems and women with addictions and anything. And he got sick. He had so much wrong with him. He walked with a walker. They had to put PVC, it looked like PVC pipes, in his legs and across the bottom of his stomach, and told him whatever he did not to have a car wreck, because if he did, it would kill him. But Roy, once the Lord got over him,
yeah,
he never complained. That boy never complained.
That's right.
And he would take in a heartbeat. He was doing jail ministry with Brother Vicky now. Never, never, never in my life would I have thought I would see him go to jail to witness. But he did. And I'm telling y'all, God can do it if you will allow him to do it in your life. He will do it.
Amen.
He will do it. There's so many stories here that, and I just thank God for this church. I just thank God for it.
Yeah,
Victor knows me.
He knew exactly who you was talking about.
Yeah. Everybody I knew who Bobby was.
Jacob, here's a
certificate of baptism, this will always remind you of this day. The old devil's gonna come at you. He's gonna try to run you. Don't let him run you no further than this day right here. You know what you did. You committed your life to Christ. You stand. Certificate of baptism. I don't know you, Derek, but I can tell. I can be with somebody 5 or 6 minutes, and I can tell from my spirit's mind up with your spirit. I believe you've got a real deal. You stay with me. Let God lead. Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.